Ja.
Alright, thanks to everybody for coming on this late Friday afternoon. Appreciate you being here. So today we're very happy to have Ulf Meissner. So Ulf is a good friend, colleague, and collaborator. He also has many titles. He's head of theory of the Helmholtz Institute, chair of theoretical nuclear physics, professor of physics, dean of faculty of mathematics and natural sciences at the University of Bonn. He's also the director at the Institute for Nuclear Physics and director at the Institute for Advanced Simulation at Forschungszentrum Jülich. Ulf received his PhD from Stony Brook working with Jerry Brown. And for over 20 years, he has been a seminal figure in nuclear physics, having pioneered many of the important and successful applications of effective field theory to low-energy nuclear physics. I should mention he will be giving 4 lectures, both at Duke and here at NC State, next week, Tuesday and Wednesday afternoon, starting at 3 o'clock each day. On Tuesday, he will be at Duke, and on Wednesday, he'll be here at NC State. Look for upcoming email announcements and posters for that. I should mention that Ulf has over 430 publications and 23,000 citations, and we are very pleased to have him visit us for the next week. And today, his talk will be on the photo stage and the fate of carbon-based life, so please join me in welcoming Ulf.
Yes, thank you, Jean, for this nice introduction. I'm happy to be here, and it's the first time that I'm at this university. And I had a pleasant day already today, and I hope I give you some entertainment about this topic, which I will address in the following 50 minutes. So here's the content of my talk. I will briefly remind you about how elements are generated in stars in the Big Bang. Then the second introduction concerns the so-called anthropic principle. Just to tell you what that is and why that could be of relevance to this talk. Then I give a brief outline, it's very pedagogical, on how you can calculate atomic nuclei ab initio, and of course I will define what ab initio really means. And the method to do this are the so-called nuclear lattice simulations. I show you main results of this formalism. And then I discuss the main point part of this talk, namely how carbon-based life is sensitive to the fundamental parameters of the standard model, and I give a summary and an outlook. And most of this work is done in collaboration of these nuclear effective field theory collaboration, which Dean is one of the main figures also. So element generation starts at the Big Bang. You all know that, so we have fusions of protons and nuclei. This is maybe most famous application of Einstein's formula equal mc squared. Of course, with relativity, c will be set to 1 later on. But like this, you can generate everything, the deuterium, helium 3, helium 4, with some energy generation in terms of neutrinos and other particles. So that is well known. Everything is very simple until helium 4. Then things become a bit more difficult because there are some gaps there. No, for example, there's no bound state with 5 nucleons, so you have to then fuse nuclei. And the question is how the life essential elements on which I will focus in this talk, maybe carbon 12 and oxygen 16, are generated. And before I come to this question of the electron transparency, be aware that the visible matter of the nucleus is made up by nuclei, so atomic nuclei, and therefore they are of relevance, not only of relevance for this talk, but also of general relevance in physics. Now I briefly discuss this Hoyle state. Of course, there are many ways of generating heavier elements, and one important process in old and hot nuclei, hot stars where central temperatures about 100 million kelvins, have been studied by Bethe and then later by Üppig, Salpeter and Hoyle in the late 50s. This is the so-called triple alpha process. So this is a process where you fuse these tightly bound helium-4 nuclei, first to generate beryllium, and I show this in more detail in a moment. Then you take a third particle, you fuse this with beryllium-8, you get carbon-12, and then you fuse this further with another helium The carbon trip is another medium for alpha nucleus, and we get oxygen 16. Now the important contribution of Fred Hoyle, that's why this state here is called the Hoyle state, was that if you do this calculation without excitation in the carbon nucleus, this was done by Ulrich and Salpeter, and you find that much too few carbon is generated, and you need a resonance enhancement to go close to the beryllium 8 plus helium 4 threshold, and then you can get sufficient amount of carbon and sufficient amount of oxygen. And this threshold is, this OS is very closely located with this threshold. This was a prediction by Hoyle from just doing a network calculation of the production of these elements. And if you calculate this in numbers, this is a state which is excited state in above the ground state of carbon 12, which is a spin in parity 0 plus with about 7.7 MeV excitation energy. And the state had already been seen, it was and finally confirmed. This is quantum numbers in 57 by Cook and I at Caltech. This is exactly where it was produced to be. It's still being mapped out experimentally. For example, transition form factors from the Hoyle state to the ground state and other states are measured at the Estalienwerk in Darmstadt. And in this talk, I will essentially discuss the theory of the Hoyle state. Now, before I go on, I go out of this talk and I show you a little movie. Movies are always good. So this is an animation about this. So here's our old star. It's not the sun, it's some older star, which is hotter and bigger, more red. And now if you focus inside of this star, you see many alphas have been formed. These are these particles here. These are alpha particles, to protons, to neutrons. And then as the density becomes, there's enough density, then you see that there's a possibility that two of these alpha particles fuse, they generate beryllium 8. Beryllium 8 itself is an unstable but long-lived isotope, but since there are many alpha particles around, the third one can fuse, and now you can generate carbon 12, and the Hoyle state is then necessary to have a resonance condition in this production so that you can not only generate enough carbon 12, but in the next step, which is not shown here, also not enough oxygen 16. And so in fact, the production of carbon oxygen is a triple wonder. So first of all, in the first step, you generate beryllium 8. This is an instable nucleus, it's not stable, but it is a very long lifetime for nuclear decays. And therefore, three alphas must be, you need a high density of alpha particles that can happen with sufficient probability. Then the Hoyle state just sits above this threshold of beryllium 8 plus alpha 4, so most of these things decay and by electromagnetic transitions, and in fact only 4 out of 10,000 decays produce stable carbon. And then also carbon is further turned into oxygen by this helium 4 plus carbon 12 to oxygen 16 plus gamma reaction, but this without resonant conditions. So it's, in fact, all this is a triple wonder. All these things have to come together to get sufficient amount of oxygen and carbon. Otherwise, we wouldn't be staying here and this talk would be finished. Now, the point is that this Hoyle state has been a big problem for nuclear theory for many decades. So it was predicted by Hoyle on network calculation and element generation. But then people tried to calculate this, and apart from alpha cluster models, which are a rough approximation only, there have been so-called ab initio calculations, where you just take the forces between two and three nucleons, and then you solve the many problem by some numerical method exactly. And the best calculation of that for a long time is so-called Lopov shell model calculation. So it's a shell model without an inert core. You treat all the nucleons as active parts in the shell model. And this was a calculation by a group from Canada, US, and Germany. This was the first paper, and then it's just been repeated. And this combined quite a bit of computing time with one of the biggest supercomputers at that time. And you see that if you, in the middle of the experiment, this is carbon 12, carbon 13, here, if you have just two nuclear forces, you see some of the levels are wrongly ordered. But if you add a three nuclear force, parameters fitted already in other nuclei, you see that you get most of the levels correctly. This is all normalized to the ground state, but in the middle there's this big gap here, so that this is the Hoyle state, which is at 7.7 MeV above the ground state, 0 plus state, and you see there's no sign of that, neither in the calculations two nuclear forces alone, or in the, if you include three nuclear forces. So you get an excellent description of the spectra, but then you don't see any trace of the Hoyle state. And therefore, if you want to understand how carbon is really formed in stars, you must be able to calculate the state, the first necessary condition, and then you can look at its properties. And related to the so-called entropic principle, which is kind of interesting because this has an interesting, many physicists react very strongly on this, so let's see how it happens here. So what is the entropic principle? The entropic principle was formulated by Carter in the mid-70s, because you know there's a theory of multiverses. We don't really know why the parameters in the very successful standard model and cosmology have the values there. The quark must have certain values, the coupling constant, electromagnetic coupling constant is 1/137. And all these parameters are kind of arbitrary. We do know where they come from. And so to give an answer to this, this entropic principle was formulated, which essentially states that the observed values of all physical and cosmological quantities are not equally probable, but they take on values restricted by the requirement that there exist sites where carbon-based life can evolve, and by the requirements that the universe be old enough for that to have already done so. And then there are various forms of this, strong, weak, and so on, and this is something which some people call purely metaphysical. So the question is, can that be tested? Can that have physical consequences? And I will try to show you that it has. In fact, you can make quite a living of using this entropic principle. Weinberg has published a paper on entropic bounds on the cosmological constant in 1987, which has by today 550 sites inspires. And Lenny Susskind has written this entropic string theory landscape paper, where in the abstract he says, whether we like it or not, the entropic principle seems to have some relevance for physics. And this is already 724 sites. So let's see. So I think one has to differentiate two levels of this. So there's a purely philosophical level, which we can debate forever, but then there's a testable physical consequence level, which I try to work out in this talk. And so here comes the Hoyle set again. So I told you that Hoyle predicted this excited state in carbon 12, and this was later, when the entropic principle was only formulated 20 years after this prediction. Herald is a prime example of the entropic principle. For example, Carl Ries in an essay about cosmology wrote that as far as we know, this is the only genuine entropic principle prediction. Then André Linde, a famous astrophysicist working at Stanford, wrote in a paper that in 1953 Hoyle made an entropic prediction of an excited state, which he calls the level of life, not Hoyle Linde, for carbon fraction stars. The level of life is kind of a catchy title for a nuclear level. And also Carter in a book in 2006 wrote that a prototype example of this kind of entropic reasoning was provided by Fred Hoyle's observation of the triple alpha process, which I just outlined to you. Now, the relevant question here was posed to me by Steve Weinberg. So when we had the first calculation of the Hoyle state, which is in this funny looking diagram, I sent this to Weinberg shortly before Christmas, and he effectively replied on Christmas Day, which is quite amazing. So he said, there was a nice quote here, thanks for the colorful graph, it makes a nice Christmas card. But the more interesting point was in his detailed question. So he was asking how sensitive the result is that the energy of the Hoyle state is near the sum of the rest energies of helium 4, beryllium 8 to the parameters of the theory. And he suspects that for a pretty broad range of parameters, the Hoyle state can be well represented as a nearly bounded beryllium 8 and helium 4. So the question is, how does the Hoyle state move relative to this threshold if you change the fundamental parameter of QCD and QED? You know, this nuclei are made of two components, the nuclear force, the strong force, and the electromagnetic force. And the underlying gauge theories are QCD and QED. And of course, that is not possible in nature, but this makes theoretical physics so nice because we can answer this question using simulation high-performance computers. So that's something poor experimentalists can never do, but we theoreticians are able to do. And that is why theory is so nice. So there are essentially two answers to this question. So in this non-entropic scenario, one assumes that the Hoyle state is some kind of cluster state, which if you have some fundamental problem,